Ok, so I posted in Piazza to one of your colleagues' questions a sample of the midterm practice, but really you should take this as a practice because, in fact, none of the questions in this midterm will be in the final, in the real exam. Similar questions will be in the final exam, but none of these specific questions. So, one thing that you may notice is the fact that the sample was created for 80-minute exams, but in fact, your exam, as posted in the course website and on Piazza and on Solar, is in fact 2 hours. The exam will start at 12 p.m. and will end at 2 p.m. on Thursday. So, the exam is 120 minutes. Do not start the exam until everybody gets the exam. I will tell you exactly when you can basically start the exam. Write all the answers in the space provided. Do not separate the sheets. Will not give you additional exam sheets. If an exam paper misses any sheets, it will not be graded. This examination is closed book exam. You are not allowed to use the textbook, calculators, lecture notes, smartphones, anything. Basically, there is a clock in the room where we are going, a wall clock. That's the only thing that you can look at to actually see how long do you still have from the exam. If you are caught copying for any reason in this class, you will be reported to Academic Integrity Office for academic dishonesty. Otherwise than that, basically use your brain during the exam. You can write either with pen or pencil. It doesn't matter. As long as you don't write with the color red, you can write with any color you like. Use well-named variables and include any documentation that you will feel necessary for the implementation problems to understand your algorithms. We will make the best effort that we can do for grading your exams. But we cannot guess if algorithms are correct, if they are very integrated or complicated. This exam will not have very, very complicated algorithms. We can understand simple algorithms that do shifting of arrays or insertion of elements in arrays or deletion of elements from arrays or from strings and so on. So let's go over the exam. The exam will have questions from all the chapters that we covered up to now. Basically, we cover problems from the chapters Introduction to Computers Programming and Java, Elementary Programming, Selections and Mathematical Functions, Characters and Strings, Loops and Methods, and Arrays and Multidimensional Arrays. That's all the material that we cover in this midterm. So, for instance, if you attempt to add an integer, a double, a byte, a long, and a double, what will be the type of the value? The type of the value, and the type of the value will be double, because it always converts all the operands to the biggest type that we have available. So, in this case, the type double. So, A would be the correct option, and you should either circle A or write A after your problem. What is the value 27 modulo 7? 25 modulo 7. So 25 is not a multiple of 7. 21 is a multiple of 7. The remainder after division of 25 with 7 is 4. So the correct result that you should write is 4. Next, circle the line or the lines given below that would add number to sum. So sum should be incremented with that given number. So the correct solution should be that sum is equal with sum plus number. Sum is incremented with the number, or sum is equal with the number plus sum. So the correct solution for this problem is C, D, and E. For full credit, like for instance, if this problem would have been, let's say, 3 points, for full points, you have to give all the possible options. So C, D, and E will give you 3 points. Any incorrect answer will deduct 1 point, any correct answer will increment with 1 point. So for instance, for 3 full points, you have to enumerate all the possible values. And as I said, any incorrect answer would decrement the points with 1. Okay. Any questions? So the only possible question is what if you get negative values, the minimum that you will get is 0. So for instance, if you have a correct value like C and two incorrect values like A and B, you still get 0. It's we are not having negative scores in this exam. Okay, next problem. Given that the Unicode of the character A is 65, what will be printed by the following statement? So in this case, we are incrementing a character with a number. And the question is the number actually printed or the character itself? The number is printed because by default, any numbers like 1 is actually an integer, and integer is a bigger type than character. A character is stored on 2 bytes and a number is stored on 4 bytes. However, if now we are casting this into a character, then the output is really B, is the letter for that specific Unicode. So in this case, it will print in fact 66. And that's the correct answer for this question. However, for a similar question, but which also does casting, so let's assume that we have another question that says, what is the result of casting to character A plus 1? That will print B. And the reason for that is that it actually computes 66 and then casts 66, which is the Unicode for the letter B. In Java, the keyword true is what? It's a Boolean literal. It's not the same with the value 0. It is a Java keyword. It has a specific name. It cannot be used for, let's say, variables and other uses like methods or class names. It's not the same with the value 1 and is not any positive integer. So the correct answers for this problem are actually A and C. Any questions? Good. Let's continue. Suppose that a program had the variable declarations shown below. Draw a circle or somehow basically note the one statements below the right, on the right hand side that will cause compilation errors. Assume that all the statements follow these declarations. So we have these declarations. Basically, we declare all of those variables in Java. And then, which one of these will actually be compilation errors? And we will see that the first one, the fourth one, and the last one. So the first one is a compilation error because D is an integer. And is assigned to F, which is a character. So integer is 4 bytes. And character is 2 bytes. So an integer does not fit into a character. So this will be an error. The next one is not an error because A was a short and D is an int, and basically any short which is 2 bytes, fits in an int, which is 4 bytes. Then we assign to C to E. C is a long, E is a double, so we can always assign a short a long on 8, which consumes 8 bytes into a double, which also consumes 8 bytes and is a real type. Next question, we want to assign the double to the character. This will be an error again, because we cannot fit a double into a car, which only has 2 bytes. So double has 8 bytes. So this is an error again. Then C is assigned D. Again, C is a log, D is an int, so this is good. Basically, we are assigning to a double, least significant 4 bits out of 8, the value of an integer, which takes 4 bytes. So smaller can fit in a bigger by just occupying half of the size. And finally, this is also an error because we are assigning a float . We try to fit any real number, like for instance a float, into a whole number type, which in our case is an integer. So this is also an error. So we had 3 errors and we detected all 3 of them. Any questions? Let's see if there are any questions. Yes, in the answer sheet you can change the solutions that were not quite exact. A and C are the correct answers for that question. You can assume that any question may have any number of choices. Most questions will have only one choice, so you can make an assumption that most questions have one answer, but you may have questions that have more than one answer. Yes, the 10 questions will be composed questions, like for instance, this will be points A, B, C in one single problem. You have 2 hours, 8 minutes per big question. That's more than enough to respond this kind of questions, like what is the output of this code. You don't need 8 minutes to think about what is the output of that code. You can just count the number of letters between M and D and give you what is the distance between those two. In this case, there are 9. There will be 10 upper level questions with multiple sub points. Any questions? Okay. Write a statement that stores a random integer in the range 15 to 25 inclusive in the variable named rand. So in this case, rand is assigned the integer part of math.random multiplied with 11 plus 15. So for math.random basically returns a value in the range between 0, including 0, and 11, but not including 11. Once we cast it to an integer, we get a value in the discrete set 0, 1, up to 10. And now when we are adding to this range, basically 15, we get an integer between 15 up to 26, 25. For I for 10. So the correct solution is this, and this is basically how is it computing that solution. It computes math.random, which is 0 to 1, multiplying with 11 is 0 to 11 as a real set, and then we have the integer part of that, which basically you can put a parenthesis here if you like and then add 15 to it, or you can put the parenthesis around the entire sum and then cast it to an integer. Either way is a correct solution. So there are actually two different correct solutions. One is the one above and one is the one in which we do the sum first and then we do the casting. Any questions? I believe you are wrong. That will give us a value that is much bigger than this one, and we can actually test it. So if this was the integer value, and we print that random number, it may print values that are bigger than 25. Like 31. Okay. The problem really asks about in this range, and that's it. In the previous question, m is equal with 25 and d is equal with 13. Where do you find, how do we compute the distance? So the specific chapter that we discussed that was actually the elementary programming chapter. You don't need to remember the indices of m and d. The only thing that you have to remember is that these letters are stored consecutively in memory, so in Unicode. So for instance, the distance between E and D is 1, F and D is 2, G and D is 3, H and D is 4, I and D is 5, J and D is 6, L and D, K and D is 7, L and D is 8, and M and D is 9. So really what you have to know is the fact that these internally are stored as Unicode values, and A is followed by B, which is followed by C, which is followed by D, and so on. So between D and M we have 1, 2, 9 letters. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Okay, next question. You are given the integer sum and count. Write the code to store the floating point quotient of sum divided by count in a double variable quotient. So the original variables are sum and count. They are double. They are integers. So we can actually compute count. Let's see. sum modulo count, and as the integer we assign it to the quotient. That's it. Yes, the Unicode of A is 65, but you really shouldn't remember that because you don't need it. It's the same with hexadecimal digits converted from binary. You shouldn't ever actually remember that table of four digits in binary was the actual hexadecimal. You can do the conversion. You can actually convert the binary into hexadecimal, or the hexadecimal into a decimal, and then convert it into the binary notation. So there is nothing to remember. Computer science is actually, as you know, in the College of Engineering, is actually an engineering science. You actually don't remember anything. You just solve problems. So there is not much to remember in this class. So, oh, the quotient is division. And since we have those two variables are integers, we get a quotient of the division, and then we assign it to a double. Thank you very much, Luigi. Yes, you can assume that the quotient is declared. Excellent. Let's continue. Problem 10. Write a statement that would declare and create an array of 200 elements and assign it to a variable named letters. This is an array of characters, so character array letters is equal with a new character array of size 200 characters. That is the statement that you have to write. Okay. Let's go to the next problem. Circle the Boolean expressions below that exhibit incorrect Java syntax. The first statement is actually incorrect, and the reason why is that there is this sign greater than equal greater. That sign does not exist in Java. Basically, you cannot have equal greater, so A is incorrect. For some reason I cannot write anymore in this file, or this I don't see the cursor. So let's write A is incorrect because equal greater should be greater than equal. Other than that, if that would be flipped, then that expression is correct, is actually true. And 3 greater than equal with 4. Next one. A different than 0, or A x is equal with 0. So B is incorrect because in the second part we have x which is not a Boolean operand. So x equal with 0 is an assignment operation, is not a comparison of x with 0. So x is equal with 0 no matter what really x is. In fact, it will actually assign x 0, an integer, and an integer is not a Boolean operand in Java. So in Java that will actually not work. Next. Point C, x is greater than 0, and x is not greater than 0, and x is greater than 0, C is correct. D is also correct. Basically, it will always, not always, but it will compute a Boolean value depending on the value of x. E is incorrect, and again, the reason is because it should be 2 comparisons. It should basically be minus 10 less than x and x less than 0. So In Java, if we compare minus 10 with x, that gives us a boolean, and we cannot compare that boolean with 0. Boolean, like, even if it's true or false, less than 0 makes no sense in Java. So these are the three options that are incorrect, and they should all be circled or labeled as incorrect. Now let's see what is the input for each one of these. And the ones that have break statements will only print the one character. So in the case of the first, the input is A. In the case of the second, because it does not have a break statement, it just continues and prints 5 times the character A. So it will print 5 A's. The next one, the next statement, will start printing C, but because there is no break, it continues and prints 2 C's. So the output is really 2 C's. Any questions? So switch statements do the comparison and then start the code from that position. That if there is no break of the block, they just continue for the rest of the block. Next code. These two codes basically are identical. One of them computes the value of even in an if statement. The second one computes the value of even in a comparison operation and assigns it to even. So they are both actually correct, and they actually are logically identically correct. So point E is the correct option. Both codes are syntactically and logically correct. Next code. If x is less than 100 and x is greater than 10, the containment should always exist. So this code, the condition itself is incorrect, has a syntax error, because that condition must be enclosed inside parentheses. So point number B is actually the reason why that statement is actually point number A is the reason why that statement is incorrect. The second one, it would be not is not necessary put the print statement within a block. So that's not the reason why that statement above is incorrect. A is the reason why. Next, we have a do-while loop. So we start with the counter 0, and in a loop, we print the message as long as the counter is plus plus is less than 9. So let's see what happens. For the counter 0, we print the message once. Then the counter is compared with 9. 0 less than 9 is true, and then we increment the counter. So this continues. Let's see what happens when we actually have the counter is 9. It's 8. 8 less than 9 is true. Then we increment the counter and we print the message again. Now 9 less than 9 is false, and it exits and prints the counter. So how many times did we print the message? First of all, what's the value of count? The value of count is 10. Basically, we incremented the count up to 10. The next question is how many times did we actually print that message? And we also printed it 10 times because we printed it for all the values from 0 to 9 included, and that is 10. So the answer is 10. If we want to write that code with a for loop, we would write a for integer count equal with 0 as long as the count is less than equal with 9 and the count is incremented with 1 at every step. We print the message. Welcome to Java. After the loop, we print the message, the count. So now we've wrote an identical statement that basically solves the same problem as the one above. Okay. Write a method that computes this series and returns the sum as a double. The value of I should be taken as a parameter to the method and should be an integer. So public static double should define the method m that takes an integer I as a parameter, and we basically compute the value of that series. So let's define a double value, let's call it result is equal initially with 0, and then for every index I starting with 1, as long as I is less than equal with the count, actually let's name it a different name, j, because I is already taken by the global, by the formal parameter. At every step, the result is incremented with the value of the double value of j divided. Let's actually make sure that we are casting just j, not the result of the division, of j divided by 2 multiplied with j plus 1. And finally, we return the result. So we wrote a method that computes exactly that series. Let's actually test it. It will take just a second to test it. So we define the method and we call, let's say, m of 1. So m of 1 should return 1 divided by 3, and that's not correct. Let's see. Okay, does anyone see what is wrong in this program? Oh, yes, I'm incrementing I in the loop instead of j. We had too many variables. Okay, good. So, thank you. Done. Finally, we have one more question. Write a method that will print the numbers from 1 to n, 7 per line, when n is an integer parameter to the method. The numbers are separated by one space. So, public static void, let's call it print. And the method print takes an integer n as a parameter. We can write a for loop that for every integer I starting from 0, as long as I is less than equal with n, actually it should start with 1, so let's start with 1. We write the value of I plus 1 space plus, and here we can actually use a Boolean expression. So if n modulo 7 is equal with 0, then we put a new line. Otherwise, we don't put anything. So let's test this method. Let's call print of, let's say, 16. Let's see, where are we wrong again. So if n, oh, if I modulo 7 is 0, then print 7 per line. Okay, we have another method. So the only problem was here, if I was. So this is called the Boolean conditional expression. If the condition is true, then it returns the value after the question mark. If the condition was false, it returns the value after the colon. So we do it in one line. Okay. Finally, write a loop that prints this pattern. So this pattern, we have to print it from for any integer n. So for instance, for 9, it will print this pattern. For other integers, it prints different patterns. We have to basically find what does it print for any random row I. So for a random row, it starts with that number of spaces. So for row 1, it starts from 1. From row 2, it starts from with one space. And then the rest of the numbers. For row 3, it starts with two spaces. For any row I, it starts with n minus 1 spaces. Then the sequence from n to the number. Then the decreasing sequence from the number to the row number, and then a new line. And this is done for in a big for loop that iterates over all the rows from row 1 to the row of that integer n. So we are going to implement it here. So for any integer n, we have to write a method, no, just a loop. So let's just write a loop in the main method. So let's assume that the integer is given to us in some variable n. In this case, it's 9. So for every integer I, starting from row number 1, as long as I is less than equal with n, and I is incremented with 1 at every step, we are going to print the preceding spaces for every integer j that starts from 0, as long as j is less than I, and j is incremented with 1 at every step. We print a space. Then we have to print the increasing sequence. So for every j starting from the value of I, as long as j is less than equal with n, we are printing the value of j. And then we have to print the decreasing sequence. So for every j that starts with n minus 1, as long as j is greater than equal with I, j is decremented with 1 at every step. We print the value of j. And then we print a new line. After each row. So that prints exactly that matrix that we wanted to print. So the response to that question is really this code. That's all for today. See you on Thursday for the exam. Thank you very much. I will post the recordings for both the midterm and the lectures in a few minutes on